The English We Speak
from BBC Learning English.
Hello, this is The English We Speak with me, Feifei.
And me, Roy.
Roy, what are you holding?
This? It's a sword.
I can see it's a sword. Why do you have one?
Well, I overheard you saying your friend Sandra is living in a bubble. So I asked my pal at the museum if I could borrow a sword to help your friend escape.
No, Roy. I said Sandra lives in a bubble, but it means that she doesn't really accept new ideas and all her friends have the same way of thinking. Living in a bubble is the expression we're looking at in this program.
Ah, that makes more sense. I just imagined that she might have got stuck in a bubble after washing her hands.
Roy, your imagination never ceases to amaze me. You know what we should do?
I think we should listen to some examples.
Bob and his friends think that climate change isn't real. They live in a bubble. Nelson lives in a bubble. He never tries new food or goes out with new people. Geraldine doesn't want to meet my new friends. She thinks they live in a bubble.
This is The English We Speak from BBC Learning English, and we're talking about the expression living in a bubble, which is used to describe someone who doesn't listen to people with different ideas, or maybe is a little sheltered from society.
I think it's sad when people live in a bubble because they don't get to experience new ideas or have their minds changed.
I don't live in a bubble. It's why I like working with you, because you have very different ideas to me and I like listening to them. You're always wrong, but I still like you.
Oh, thanks, Feifei. I guess I should take this sword back to the museum.
You should. Bye, Roy.
Bye.
The English We Speak
from BBC Learning English.
Hello and welcome to The English We Speak. I'm Feifei.
And I'm Neil. Hey, Feifei, it sounds like you might have a cold.
I think I have. Sore throat, blocked nose. I feel terrible. That's why I'm taking this medicine.
That's probably a good idea. Medicine is usually good for making you feel better. But how does it taste?
Well, it's supposed to taste of strawberries, but to be honest, it's just horrible.
That's why I never take the stuff. It's disgusting. Have you heard the phrase, a taste of your own medicine?
No. Does it mean doing something horrible or unpleasant?
Sort of. It describes someone receiving the same treatment or unpleasant experience that they've given to somebody else. You know, like you're always bossing people around and then someone starts to boss you around.
I don't know what you mean, Neil. Anyway, it's quite a negative phrase.
It is. Let's hear some examples.
Our boss is so rude to us. But finally, somebody has answered back, and now he's got a taste of his own medicine.
When I meet up with my boyfriend, he's always late. So this time, I'm going to give him a taste of his own medicine and turn up late as well.
Deepak is always rude to the teacher, but he was really offended when she gave him a taste of his own medicine and was rude back to him.
So, that's a taste of your own medicine, which describes someone receiving the same treatment that they have given to somebody else.
What?
Excuse me.
Oh dear, it sounds like you need to take some more medicine.
If you mean literally taking the medicine, then yes. But if you mean receiving the same treatment I've given to someone else, then no. I can't believe you think I'm always bossing people around.
I was just giving an example of the phrase. I would never say that you're bossy.
Good. Now, why don't you go and make me a nice cup of tea?
Oh, okay. Yeah, sure. See ya.
Oh, and don't forget to close the door.
Yes, sorry. I'll do that right now. Okay. See you later.
I feel better already. Bye.
The English We Speak
from bbclearningenglish.com.
Hello and welcome to The English We Speak. I'm Feifei.
And I'm Rob. And I am so excited.
Oh yeah? Why's that, Rob?
You know, Feifei, it's that festive time of year. Presents, parties, time with the family, snow. Oh, did I mention presents?
Yes, Rob. It's Christmas time.
Come on, Feifei, aren't you excited? Imagine if we had lots of Christmases, all at the same time.
Oh no, think of the cost of buying all those presents.
But hopefully you'd receive lots of presents too. Anyway, do you know that for some people, all their Christmases can come at once?
I don't think so.
Okay, well, they're not really Christmases, but if someone has extreme good fortune, it's like the feeling of having lots of Christmases all at the same time.
Ah, I got it. Having all your Christmases come at once just means having lots of good luck.
Yes. Let's hear from some people who've had all their Christmases come at once. Lucky them.
Yay, I got a pay rise. And I'm off on holiday tomorrow. And I've won the lottery. Seems like all my Christmases have come at once.
The day I got married, I heard I'd passed my exams and got a promotion. So it felt like all my Christmases had come at once.
All my Christmases have come at once. My parents bought me a new car. I got a place at university and I've got a new girlfriend.
This is The English We Speak from BBC Learning English. And we're learning about the phrase to have all your Christmases come at once, which means to have extreme good fortune. Did you know, Rob, that I've had lots of good luck?
No, what's happened?
Well, I've been invited to a big swanky Christmas party tonight. I'm going skiing at the weekend and you've bought me an amazing Christmas present.
Have I?
Yes, in that box over there.
Oh, that's not for you, sorry. It looks like not all of your Christmases have arrived.
Oh, well. You may as well have your present now.
A book of English phrases. How useful.
It will be. Happy Christmas, Rob.
Same to you, Feifei.
The English We Speak.
From bbclearningenglish.com.
Hello and welcome to The English We Speak. I'm Feifei.
And hello, I'm Rob.
What is that smell?
Smell? I can't smell anything.
There's definitely a terrible smell, like mouldy cheese. What's in that bag, Rob?
Oh, this bag. You're right. It is cheese. Beautiful, delicious Stilton cheese, in fact. Would you like some?
No. So why have you got a bag of mouldy cheese?
Well, I stopped at the cheese shop on the way to the office and saw this cheese was half price. And you probably know I have a good nose for a bargain.
I don't think so, Rob. Judging by this cheese, you have a bad nose. It smells awful.
No, Feifei, when you have a nose, or even a good nose for something, it's not about your sense of smell. It describes someone who is naturally good at finding and recognising something. In my case, finding a bargain.
I'm not so sure about that, Rob. Well, I have a good nose for finding examples, so here they are.
We need to sell more newspapers, so we need to find a reporter with a good nose for a story.
I have a good nose for learning languages and was fluent in Spanish in just a year.
My mum's got a nose for bargains and booked us all flights to Italy for just £50 each.
This is The English We Speak from BBC Learning English, and we're finding out about the phrase to have a good nose for something. Rob claims to have one, but I'm not so sure. So, how much did you pay for this cheese, Rob?
Oh, only £20. It was half price.
That's because it's old. Look, it's going green. Sorry, Rob, this cannot stay in the studio. It stinks. Out it goes.
Oh, that's not very nice.
Hold on. I can still smell something bad. It's your socks. Look, you haven't got your shoes on. Ugh.
Wow, Feifei, you really have got a good nose. A good nose for bad smells.
Your bad smells, Rob.
Time to go. Bye.
Bye.
The English We Speak.
From bbclearningenglish.com.
Hello and welcome to The English We Speak. I'm Feifei.
And I'm Rob. Phew, Feifei, is the air conditioning on?
Let me check. Looks like it's broken.
Again? The company fixed it just this week.
Yeah.
And that's 3 times this month.
I know.
I honestly can't face calling the company one more time. I've wasted hours on the phone to them. Seriously.
Okay, Rob. No need to get so hot under the collar.
But, oh, okay, you're right. Give me a minute.
While Rob is cooling down, let me explain that phrase I just used. To get hot under the collar means to become very annoyed or angry about something. There is another meaning, but we'll get there later. Okay, Rob, how are you now?
Oh, just a minute more.
Okay, let's listen to these examples first.
Nick got a little hot under the collar when he returned from a meeting to discover his colleagues had eaten all his chocolates.
I hate driving in big cities. I just get too hot under the collar when others drive badly. I prefer to take a bus and chill out.
Try not to say anything about Wayne's new haircut. He knows it looks terrible. When I mentioned it, he got very hot under the collar.
This is The English We Speak from BBC Learning English. So, how are you feeling now, Rob?
Oh, much better. Don't worry, I'll call the air conditioning company.
If you do, can you ask them which engineer is coming to fix it?
Why does that matter?
Well, you see, there is this one engineer who makes me all hot under the collar.
Ah, I see. You find this person attractive and they make you feel excited or even a bit nervous. Well, that's the other meaning of hot under the collar, by the way.
Well, yes, sorry, I should admit it. It's been me who has been breaking the air conditioning all along. Just in the hope that...
Just so you can see that cute engineer. Feifei, that really is shocking. Okay, let me make that call.
Yes, it's getting a bit hot in here. Bye.
Bye.
Ooh. The English We Speak.
From bbclearningenglish.com.
This is The English We Speak. I'm Feifei.
And hello, I'm Rob.
Rob, it's very kind of you to bring me to this cafe and to buy me a milkshake. I love milkshakes.
Did I say I was paying? Anyway, I wanted to talk to you about work.
Strawberry. My favourite.
Yes, me too. But back to talking about work. You know we're moving the desks around.
Why do milkshakes taste so good? Oh, look, I've finished mine.
As I was trying to say, it looks like you've got the short straw.
Oh, that's why I've drunk my milkshake quicker than you. I had a short straw.
No, Feifei, forget the milkshake. If you get or draw the short straw, it means you're the person in a group who gets the most unpleasant outcome in a situation.
Right, and why have I got the short straw?
Well, I'm afraid they're moving your desk to just outside the toilet.
We'll see about that. Let's hear some examples of other people who've got the short straw.
Oh, looks like I've got the short straw. I'm doing the late shift while everyone else goes to the pub.
Oh dear, Tom's got to do the washing up after our dinner party. Looks like he's got the short straw.
Oh, we were given free tickets to the theatre, but I got the short straw because my seat was right at the back and I couldn't see a thing.
This is The English We Speak from BBC Learning English, and we're talking about the expression to get the short straw, which describes a person in a group who gets the most unpleasant or difficult outcome in a situation. You can also say to draw the short straw. And Rob, you're saying I've got the short straw in the office reshuffle.
Yep. That's why I thought I'd take you for a milkshake, as a way of making you feel better about it.
You mean as a way of saying sorry, more like? I've seen the new office plan, and you were supposed to sit by the toilet, but you changed the name to mine. What a cheek.
Well, how about if I pay for your milkshake?
Maybe if you buy me another milkshake.
Okay then. Remind me what flavour?
Strawberry, with two long straws.
The English We Speak.
From BBC Learning English.
Hello and welcome to The English We Speak. With me, Feifei.
And me, Roy.
We may sound a little different. That's because we're not able to record in our normal studios during the coronavirus outbreak. In this programme, we have an expression that is used to describe publicly criticising someone. Roy, why are you hiding under the desk?
Well, I'm a bit scared at the moment. Neil said you were throwing shade at me, so I don't want to get hit. I guess it was you who smashed the window, throwing all that shade around.
Roy, I'm not throwing anything physically. I was throwing shade at you. That means I was publicly criticising you. I was telling everyone how terrible your favourite T-shirt is. You always wear it, but the film on it, it's so uncool. Who likes Gibbons by the Sea?
I do. It's a brilliant film. You should stop throwing shade. I love this T-shirt. It's a classic.
It's not a classic. It's old. Also, I did smash that window as I literally threw a bag of your other terrible T-shirts out of the window. We'll talk about it more after these examples.
Edje got really angry when she caught her friend throwing shade at her. Hey, don't throw shade at my job. It may not pay well, but I enjoy it. Joan never throws shade. She's so chilled out.
This is The English We Speak from BBC Learning English, and we're talking about the expression throw shade, which describes the act of publicly criticising someone.
I can't believe you threw my bag of T-shirts out the window. I know you don't like my T-shirts, but you should stop throwing shade at me.
Okay, I will. I'm sorry, Roy. Actually, do you want to know a secret? I love your T-shirts. I wanted to buy one, but I couldn't find one.
Well, I have a spare in the bag. You can have my other Gibbons by the Sea T-shirt, and then we can have matching T-shirts in the office. We'll look so cool.
Yes, we will. Bye, Roy.
Bye, Feifei.
The English We Speak.
From bbclearningenglish.com.
This is The English We Speak. I'm Feifei.
And hello, I'm Rob. Hey, Feifei, did you see the match last night?
The match? No, Rob, I had better things to do.
Oh, you should have done. My local team beat Manchester United 3-0. It was a giant killing.
Well, I'm glad I didn't watch it. Who wants to see giants being killed?
Feifei, nobody was killed, and there were no real giants. The giant is the team that is usually stronger, more powerful or skillful than the other team. And the killing happens when the weaker or less skillful team beats them. And that's what happened last night. It was brilliant.
I see. So a giant killing describes a situation when a weaker or less skillful person or team beats a stronger or more skillful opponent.
Yep. And we call the winning team giant killers. So my team can be called giant killers.
So is this phrase used for sporting competitions?
Yes, it is. It's not just used in football, although the giant killing in the game last night was amazing. I mean, did I mention the score was 3-0?
OK, calm down, Rob. Let's hear some other examples of the phrase giant killing.
We're celebrating our village cricket team's giant killing over a professional county team.
There was a giant killing at the tennis match today. A brand new player beat the third-seeded player in straight sets.
The non-league team have become giant killers in the FA Cup. They could go all the way to the final.
This is the English We Speak from BBC Learning English, and we're hearing about the sporting expression giant killing. That's when a strong or skillful player or team is beaten by a less strong opponent. The winners are called giant killers. So a giant killing is quite an achievement.
Ah, it sure is. It's unexpected, but it's great when it happens.
I understand, Rob. It comes as a surprise because you're so used to losing.
Never mind, Feifei. If you're not a football fan, you'll never understand.
I suppose this programme is a bit like a giant killing.
Why is that then?
The weaker, less skillful presenter beats the stronger, more skillful presenter by getting more lines to say in the script.
I don't think so, Feifei. You always have more to say.
That's true. Now, isn't it your turn to make the tea?
Oh, OK, if you say so. See you later.
Ha, 1-0 to me. Bye.
The English We Speak.
From BBC Learning English.
Good to be back at work, Neil.
Yes, Feifei. I feel a bit better now. Just a little... just a bit of a cough.
Anyway, it's good to have you here. Because you can finally pay me.
Oh, right. Why is that?
Well, remember you said you didn't believe I could stand on my head?
I do. I said I would give you £10 if you can do it.
Yes, well...
No way!
There we are, on my head. £10, please. Time to cough up, Neil.
Okay. You can come down now.
Not bad, huh? Now, how about you cough up and I explain what it means?
Hey, I was only joking about the £10. Oh, okay. There you go.
Thank you. If you cough up, it means you give someone money, especially if you don't want to.
Yes, I didn't want to give Feifei the money, but I said I would, so I had to cough up.
Indeed. Time for some examples.
I waited 2 whole weeks for my new TV to be delivered, and then I had to cough up an extra £15 for the delivery. I can't believe it.
My last trip to the library was expensive. I had to cough up for the fines for all the books I'd returned late. Whoops.
When I sat on my colleague's glasses, he asked me to cough up £100 to buy a new pair. Though I must admit, the new ones are an improvement.
You're listening to The English We Speak from BBC Learning English. The expression we're looking at in this programme is to cough up.
Neil, that cough is still sounding bad. Have you tried the cough medicine I use?
Not yet. It's just a little expensive. £10 for a little bottle of medicine.
It's worth it. Listen, if you won't cough up, I'll give you the £10 back if you promise to buy it.
That's very kind.
Not a problem. And while you go to the pharmacy, I'm going to practice presenting the programme standing on my head. It's good for blood circulation, apparently.
Standing on your head is one thing, but presenting a whole programme, no way.
Are you sure? £10 says I can.
Okay then. Bye.
Bye.
The English We Speak.
From bbclearningenglish.com.
Hello and welcome to The English We Speak. I'm Neil and...
Hi everyone, I'm Feifei and I've just, well...
Feifei's here with me. Feifei, what's going on?
Yes, and today we're here with you, dear learners of the wonderful English language.
What are you looking for?
The script, Neil. I misplaced it somewhere.
Just wing it.
Wing it? Wing like a bird. Yes, the air is fresh and I flap my wings.
What are you doing? What are you doing?
You told me to pretend I was a bird. Or to tell the story of a bird. Or I know lots of bird jokes.
No, that's not it. In English, to wing something means to improvise. This informal expression is thought to come from the theatre and it refers to performances given by actors who had to learn their lines quickly while waiting in the wings.
Ah, The wings are the space on each side of the stage where actors wait before coming onto the stage. Sometimes someone gives them their lines from there as support.
That's right. Let's hear how this expression is used.
Mary spent all weekend partying instead of studying. When I asked her why she wasn't concerned about the exam, she told me she'd just wing it.
The minister is a great orator. He's never had a speech ready. He just wings it and people love it.
So a theatrical expression for you. Now, Feifei, do you know lots of jokes about birds? Tell me one.
Why did the little bird get in trouble at school?
No idea.
Because he was caught tweeting during the test.
Yes, very funny.
Bye.
Goodbye.
Hi, everyone. We hope you enjoyed that video. And thank you very much for watching. We have so many more just like it. So if you don't want to miss a single one, make sure to subscribe and we will see you regularly. Hope to see you soon. Bye, guys.